So yes, guys, as let's say I have given you a laptop in my office. You've been using that laptop. I have capitalized the asset. I started charging depreciation on that particular asset. And I said the useful life of this asset is about 5 years. Now, suddenly at a point of time during this 5 years period, you were carrying the laptop from one place to other and suddenly dropped. Now, though it was broken here and there, you somehow, you know, you just joined all the pieces and it was still in a working condition. You did not really inform me, but I saw that there's a broken condition laptop which is out there. Now, the question is, I said I'll be charging a depreciation for the loss in the value. But unfortunately, is this loss in value a regular loss in value of the asset? I said over 5 years period, I want to replace this asset. Absolutely correct. But I'm saying the loss which happened here, is it a normal loss which can be calculated as depreciation? Absolutely no. Now that is where we have to concentrate and talk about a new concept which is discussed as per IND AS 36. Impairment of assets. What does this impairment deal with and how do I calculate this impairment? What does it actually mean? Let's understand in incomplete sense. First thing which I want to talk about, this word impairment out here. When I say this word impairment, impairment in general sense means it is loss in value of asset. Well, whenever there's a loss in value of an asset, you need to understand the reasons for which the loss has actually happened. I'm using the word loss. And the similar definition has been given even under your depreciation as well. Depreciation is a loss in value of asset arising due to three reasons: effluxion of time, wear and tear on use, and technological changes. Then what am I charging impairment for? I am charging impairment for reasons of loss which are other than these three. So I'm saying loss in value, which is arising due to reasons other than depreciation. Loss in value of asset arising due to a reason which is other than depreciation. So when we look at depreciation, the first thing that you have to understand is what is the reasons for which depreciation is charged. Depreciation normally is charged for three particular reasons. Number one, due to effluxion of time. Or number two, wear and tear on use. Or number three, obsolescence of technology. These are the three particular reasons for which you can actually charge depreciation. But however, we are saying it is for arising due to reasons other than depreciation. Here I can stay on the same point and I say, can say that impairment arises due to isolated non-recurring events. Why did I say isolated non-recurring events? Why am I using these words? Because you don't expect them to happen often. If I talk about depreciation, effluxion of time, wear and tear on use, or your technological obsolescence is a regular phenomenon. Across any asset, you will find that these are regular phenomena which happen on a day-to-day basis. But, and I'm talking about reasons other than this, like a physical damage which has been suffered by an asset, which is beyond a normal damage, then in such cases, I will say that it is an isolated non-recurring events. Such isolated non-recurring events is what we can affiliate to the loss in the value of an asset being contributed in the name of impairment. So impairment of an asset arises due to loss, and such loss is due to reasons which are other than the depreciation being cited for. So if you want me to give some examples for this, I can quote certain examples. Physical damage. Or fall in utility of the asset. Closing down of facility. I'm closing down a particular facility for which this asset was used. Then in such cases, which are isolated non-recurring events, there could be an impairment which can be attributed for. Now, when I'm talking about this case of impairment, we will have to understand in essence what exactly is impairment and how do we calculate or measure it. So if I'm talking about measurement criteria, I'm not talking about recognition yet. If I'm talking about measurement, my measurement of impairment loss can be given this way. My measurement of impairment loss can be calculated as impairment loss is equal to, or impairment of asset is equal to, carrying value of asset minus recoverable amount. Now, in essence, let us understand what exactly this definition means. I'm talking about computation of impairment loss, and I said impairment can be calculated this way: carrying value of asset reduced by the amount of recoverable amount. What is carrying value and what is recoverable amount? Let us try to understand now. If I'm talking about carrying value of an asset, it simply means it is a book value of asset. Book value of asset indicates the cost of the asset reduced by the amount of accumulated depreciation on it. But if I'm talking about recoverable amount, this is where the standard really comes into picture. Because this term has been first time quoted in the standards, and this is the only place where we use it. Recoverable amount can be given as higher of, number one, value in use, or net selling price. What is this word, net selling price? Net selling price can be indicated this way: the estimated fair value of asset on disposal reduced by minus estimated cost of disposal. So I am saying that there will be a cost of disposal that will inevitably incur at the time of disposal of an asset. What is fair value? The value at which you can actually transact a particular, say, the asset for its disposal is called as estimated fair value of disposal. And this, in short, can be called as net selling price. The standard predominantly revolves around identifying your value in use and identifying your net selling price. Now, and also we'll have to talk about recognition of impairment loss on assets. Now guys, this standard, since it said the word assets, then it should apply to every asset. Well, that is not so. The standard specifically excludes certain items which should not be covered under this. Now, what are those items which are specifically excluded from the scope of the standard? Let us try to understand these exclusions from the scope, then we can see what the standard actually talks about. Yes guys, so we were talking about impairment and I told you a certain assets are excluded from the scope of the standard. Exclusions from scope. Now what are these assets which are excluded from its scope? Let us understand one by one. When we say that there is a certain exclusions from the scope, the exclusions basically include, number one, inventories covered under IND-AS 2. This is the first exclusion. The second exclusion from the standard is about assets arising from construction contracts discussed under IND AS 11. At the same time, deferred tax asset, this is discussed as per a separate standard, IND AS 12. Assets arising from employee benefits, we call them as plan assets. We will look at what these plan assets are when we discuss IND AS 19. Biological assets are also out of the scope of the standard, and these biological assets are covered as per IND AS 41. We also exclude non-current assets held for sale. And these assets are governed as per IND AS 105. Further exclusions of mineral rights separately governed as per IND AS 106. Insurance contracts governed as per IND AS 104. And the final exclusion is financial assets governed as per IND AS 109. Now these are assets as per the financial statements, but these assets particularly are excluded from the scope of the standard. Now the question comes up, first of all, why are these excluded from the scope of the standard? So that means the asset does not get impaired if it falls under these headings. Let us try to assess one by one. First one I'm talking about is inventory. When we look at the word inventory, understand inventory by itself, the recognition criteria is lower of NRV or cost. That means the fall in the value of inventory is already recognized as per IND AS 2. Whenever the value of inventory falls below the cost, I will recognize the value of inventory at its NRV and we will ignore the cost. This was the concept that we have learnt. Now if I observe that already impairment is being recognized as per the same standard according to their measurement principle, I don't need again IND AS 36 to talk about. Similarly, assets arising from construction contracts, we have a separate paragraph which will discuss regarding recognition of losses. Your IND AS 12 also has a specific paragraph which will talk about review and reassessment of deferred tax assets. So the employee benefit standard is perfectly as per fair valuation given by a professional valuer. It is based on the valuation principle itself is based on fair valuation. From where will impairment come when the valuation itself is based on fair valuation? Now the same thing when you look at biological assets, mineral rights and insurance contracts, they're typical business transactions, they're specific business transactions which are out of the any scope of the standard, because these three standards are standing all by itself, entire recognition principles will be different. Non-current assets held for sale, I'm holding that asset for sale, what do you want to impair? Even under IND AS 105, the recognition criteria is lower of its realizable value or carrying cost. When I said lower of its carrying cost or realizable value, there itself I am calculating the impairment, I am recognizing the impairment. So I don't need again IND AS 36 to discuss about it. Financial assets, impairment of financial assets are specifically dealt in the standard. You don't need another standard to talk about. This way, there is a particular reason for which each exclusion has been named out here. Got it? Now, we will talk about certain peculiar situations that will arise. I will talk about the first kind of that situation which arises here is because if the value in use of an asset cannot be measured reliably, in such case, the recoverable amount will be considered as net selling price. This situation will arise when I cannot identify or cannot determine what is the value in use. Why does this situation arise where I cannot determine this value in use? The reason why I cannot determine value in use is because sometimes there could be a situation where the value in use of a particular asset cannot be identified in a particular manner. Value in use. In use, what is the value that we derive? Value in use predominantly uses discounted cash flow approach, that is income approach as far as IND AS 113 is concerned. Guys, when we are following income approach and discounted cash flow model, it is difficult for us sometimes to actually determine what are the cash flows arising from the use of a particular asset. You can say that there is a benefit, I'm not able to quantify the benefit. When I am not able to quantify the benefit which I am deriving from that, it will be difficult for us to determine what is value in use. Such kind of assets, we will have to go as far as net selling price is concerned. For example, let us say there is a receptionist table out there. A table which is allocated for the receptionist, that is capitalized as an asset. Now I asked you, sir, what is the economic benefit being derived out of that particular asset? Had that asset not been there, the enterprise would have been functioning exactly the same way. Is it really necessary for it? Now, that is what is a question. Certain assets I'm talking about where value in use cannot be determined reliably, we will use net selling price as its recoverable amount. Number two. If the fair value of asset exceeds the carrying value of asset, then in such situation, value in use, VIU, need not be identified. Observe why I said this. I said this because recoverable amount is higher of value in use or net selling price. Higher of net selling price. Your net selling price is already greater than carrying value. Even if your value in use is lower than the carrying amount, I will say recoverable amount is higher of value in use or fair value. So fair value will be chosen as a recoverable amount. Then there is no impairment loss being measured. So for example, when I'm talking about impairment, I said impairment loss is equal to carrying value minus recoverable amount. And now I'm saying that this recoverable amount is higher of value in use or net selling price. When we are saying this is the situation which is happening, understand, I am telling you that was if my fair value of the asset is already higher than the carrying value, then that means the recoverable amount will definitely exceed the impairment, the carrying value. There is no impairment loss. Same way, I will draft one more sentence. If the value in use is greater than carrying value of asset, then in such situation, net selling price need not be identified. I'm just putting a vice versa situation out here. I'm saying that the value in use itself has exceeded carrying value, then what is the point of identifying the net selling price? I don't need to determine my net selling price because already your recoverable amount exceeded the carrying amount. If recoverable amount is greater than carrying amount, then there's no point of recognizing your value in your impairment loss. 100 rupee recover your carrying value, your net selling price was itself 110. If your net selling price was 110, your recoverable amount anyways is higher of 110 or VIU. So at least 110 is for sure. If I take 100 minus 110, impairment loss becomes negative, I can't recognize that. So in essence, what we are saying is, if one of the value which you have identified exceeds the carrying value, then you don't have to identify the other one. Because you need to understand that your impairment loss in such situation will always be considered as zero. And the first exception which I told you, sometimes where I cannot identify the value in use, because that I cannot determine or quantify the economic benefit derived from a particular asset, in such way, we will say that the recoverable amount is considered as net selling price. We will not understand the value in use anymore. Got it? Yes, guys, just like we have discussed earlier, we have to determine what is your net selling price and value in use. I'll start with the net selling price first. My net selling price can be indicated as estimated fair value reduced by estimated cost of disposal. I'll have to see what exactly is this, how to estimate the fair value and how to estimate this cost of disposal. Now, when I'm first talking about estimated fair value, this word estimated fair value here on the standard has to be understood in reference to IND AS 113, which discusses about fair value. What do we discuss in fair value concept as far as IND AS 113 is concerned? As far as IND AS 113 is concerned, we will have to understand that fair value is defined as per the standard this way. It is a price at which It is a price at which an asset can be sold or a liability can be transferred between market participants in an orderly transaction on a measurement date. This is in particular how I can explain what a fair value is. Let us see what it actually stands for. A price at which an asset can be sold. This is what I am concerned about. At which a liability can be transferred. This is not applicable for us. Or a liability can be transferred. This is not applicable at all for us. Between the market participants. This word market participant means willingful and knowledgeable. Buyers or sellers. Willingful and knowledgeable buyers. Willingful, that means there should be a willingness to transact. He should be willing to transact. He should not be forced to transact in a particular manner. Knowledgeable, that means the buyer knows what he is buying. At the same time, the seller knows what he is selling. The good is used for a particular purpose. Let's say, for example, I am talking about a particular product. Let's say sell a mobile phone. Someone has assumed, the buyer has assumed that a mobile phone is used only for talking. But unfortunately, when we actually look at the list of the, you know, the facilities which are being provided, the seller says you can take a you can use a mobile phone for multiple purposes like multitasking. You can use it for your clicking your pictures and multiple other functions. So understand, the buyer and seller should have the same identical minds. Orderly transaction. What does this mean? Orderly transaction indicates arm's length transaction price. Arm's length transaction price. The price at which the market participants can negotiate a transaction in an arm's length transaction. That means between two unrelated parties, what is the transaction price? That price can be referred to as fair value. On a measurement date. What date am I talking about? The date on which impairment is assessed. The date on which impairment of an asset is being assessed. That date, what is the value? So the price at which an asset can be sold, I'm eliminating this, between market participants. That means those buyer and seller should be knowledgeable and should be willingful to transact, not a forced manner. And the price should be based on an arm's length transaction price between two unrelated parties and on the date on which the impairment is being assessed. This value will be considered to be my fair value. Then come to this part now. Cost of disposal. How do I identify the estimated cost of disposal? Estimated cost of disposal includes the transaction cost, fee for transfer of assets. Or cost to render the asset marketable. What is this then? We're saying that it should include a transaction cost. That means a cost for entering into a transaction, commission, brokerage. That is cost for entering into a transaction. At the same time, it should include a fee for transfer of asset. Now, what is the fees for transfer of asset? For transfer of asset, is there a fee? Yes. Especially when you're talking about land, there's a stamp duty which I have to pay. Now, such value is what we are talking about. Cost to render the asset marketable. To make it marketable, what do you have to do? Let's say I had to post an ad on OLX. Now, OLX is going to charge me for that. So that is a price which I paid to render the asset marketable. All these costs can be included into your estimated cost of disposal. So I'm saying net selling price is estimated fair value minus estimated cost of disposal. We have explained what is fair value. We have explained what is cost of disposal of asset. Now, let us talk about determination of fair value. Very important and interesting concept, guys. How to determine a fair value of an asset. Now, go in the order, okay? Number one, binding sale agreement exists. If a binding sale agreement exists, and your answer is yes for this, in such situation, the price, what we are going to call it as fair value, will be the agreed price. The price at which you have agreed to dispose the asset will be the agreed price, will be considered as fair value. Now, let's get into this. Is it necessary that always there is a fair binding sale agreement? Need not be. So let's say there is no binding sale agreement. Then see if an active market exists. For the asset. If an active market exists for the asset and your answer is yes, then the fair value will be determined as bid price. Bid price is a price which is offered to sell the asset. That is bid price. Ask price is a price at which you require to buy the asset. Here I am talking about bid price. And remember, one more he has said. If bid price is not available, if you do not have bid price, then use the recent transaction price. Use the most recent transaction price. This is only when the bid price is not available. Now, what if the active market does not exist? If the active market does not exist, then we'll determine fair value based on observable factors. Most observable factors will be considered in determining the fair value. But however, if this is also not possible, then in such case, we will stop identifying fair value. We will say that here, the recoverable amount in that situation will be equal to value in use. In such case, it will be equal to value in use. So I said, first identify if there is a binding sale agreement for the asset. We had this even in Ind AS 17 leases, we call it as guaranteed residual value. If there is a binding sale agreement which is already negotiated between the buyer and the seller, then take the agreed price at which the enterprise has agreed to sell the asset under the binding sale agreement. If the binding sale agreement does not exist, then use the active market. If an active market exists for the asset, then use the bid price. If bid price is also not available, then in such situation, I will adopt the most recent transaction price. However, the most recent transaction price has to undergo certain adjustments. Because let's say this transaction happened in January and you are measuring the asset for its impairment loss in March. If there is certain changes which have happened between January to March, all such adjustments have to be done. Now, if the active market does not exist, then determine the fair value based on market observable factors. This terminology is used as per Ind AS 113. Most visible factors is what we will consider. Even using the visible factors, I am not able to identify it. Then in such situation, we will start saying that don't identify the net selling price any further. Stop identifying net selling price. Say that your recoverable value is equal to your value in use. Now, how to determine value in use is again a separate concept which we'll have to discuss. So let me collectively put across what we have understood. We said fair value of an asset is required for me to identify your net selling price. Because your net selling price can be given as estimated fair value on disposal of an asset reduced by the cost of disposal. For identifying the cost of disposal, I said it includes a price which is required to be paid to render the asset marketable, like OLX advertisement or classified advertisement, which I have to do. Number two, all the transaction costs which are involved. Transaction cost includes any commission, brokerage, etc. And any fees required to be paid for transfer of asset, vehicle, transfer fee, land, registration fee. All these are certain expenses which are supposed to be borne at the time of disposal of the asset. All this cost of disposal have to be incurred. Now, talking about fair value, we again referred it back to Ind AS 113, where we are saying that we have to go as per the fair value measure. How to determine fair value? The price at which the asset can be sold or liability can be transferred, I eliminated it because I'm talking about impairment of assets, not liabilities at all. So I'm leaving that part. Asset can be sold between the market participants. Market participants are those people who have sufficient knowledge about the good and they have willingness to transact. In an orderly transaction, in an arm's length transaction price, that means the price is not influenced due to any reason. On a particular measurement date, the date on which the impairment of an asset is being assessed. Now, all this put together, I said, to determine fair value, this is the hierarchy of valuation that we adopt. If I have already entered into a binding sale agreement, apply the binding sale agreement price. If the binding sale agreement does not exist, then see if the asset is an active market. If the asset has an active market, use the bid price. If the bid price is not available having an active market, then use the most recent transaction price and make certain adjustment up to the date of transaction. If active market also does not exist, then observable factors of the market have to be considered in determining the fair value. All observable factors will be considered. If observable factors consideration also is not helping us identify the fair value, then forget about fair value. Forget about net selling price altogether. Say that your recoverable value is equal to value in use and stop. This will sum up the entire identification of net selling price. This was only the first part of recoverable amount. Because recoverable amount is higher of net selling price or value in use. If this is net selling price, how do I determine the value in use? That becomes a very, very interesting concept to determine. Yes, guys. So let us determine and understand what is the second part of recoverable amount. How did we define a recoverable amount? Higher of value in use or net selling price. We have seen net selling price, so I'm talking about value in use now. When I talk about value in use, which I in short call it as VIU, VIU can be indicated as present value of cash flows arising from continuing use of the asset. I'll repeat what I said. I'm saying that value in use is present value of cash flows arising from continuing use of assets. Present value of cash flows arising from continuing use of assets. Now understand, there are two determinants which I have to predominantly indicate in this. One is the cash flow, other one is the present value. When I say present value, I'm indicating towards a discount factor. So I will say there are two determinants of this. And my two determinants are nothing but estimated cash flows and appropriate discount rate. Appropriate discount rate. These are the two things that we have to indicate. Now let us try to understand what is included under each one. If I am talking about estimated cash flows, how do I estimate a cash flow? When I'm talking about value in use, the estimated cash flows can be determined this way. An estimated cash flow includes, number one, cash inflows arising from use of asset. Number two, cash outflows necessary to derive benefit from the asset. And the third one is net cash flow from disposal of asset at its end of useful life. At the end of its useful life. These are three things that we'll have to take into consideration for estimating the cash flows. Cash inflows arising from the use of the asset. Now, as long as I use the asset, I derive some benefit. Such benefit has to be quantified in terms of money, and such amount will be indicated as cash flows. So cash flows arising from continuing use of the asset, or cash outflows necessary to indicate such use. So we'll have to consider this as cash outflows because they are necessary for deriving the benefit. What are cash outflows which are necessary for deriving the benefit? Maintenance, certain additional costs like oil, diesel, all these are additional costs which I have to incur to derive the benefit from the asset. Net cash flows, that means net of any disposal cost, amount arising from disposal of the asset. So that is nothing but my net selling price that I will derive, not today, but at the end of the useful life. These are my cash flows. and such cash flows have to be laid down according to their time factors, and such cash flows should be discounted to their present value using an appropriate discount rate. What is this word appropriate discount rate now? When I use the word appropriate discount rate, I am indicating towards a rate which represents the current market assessment, the current market assessment of time value of money. In addition to that, time value of money plus any risk associated with the asset. Any particular risk that you find with the asset, all those asset risk has to be added to the time value of money, and this will represent the appropriate discount rate to be adopted. Now, is it necessary always that I have to identify this appropriate discount rate? Very much possible in a few situations where the appropriate discount rate cannot be identified. Then what do I do? Alternatively, an enterprise can use, number one, either they can use WACC, weighted average cost of capital, or number two, incremental borrowing rate. If you cannot identify the time value, then you can use WACC or you can use time incremental borrowing rate. These rates alternatively can be used if you cannot identify the discount rate as current market assessment of time value of money adjusted by the risk associated with that particular asset. Now, I said a lot of things, man. I said cash inflows, I'm talking about discount rate. Now, when I said cash inflow, okay, discount rate is subjective regarding time value of money, keeps on changing from asset, from person to person, enterprise to enterprise. But when I'm talking about the cash inflows and cash outflows arising from use of the asset or continuing use of the asset, how do I determine them? Now, in determination of cash flows, what are the factors to be considered? Factors to be considered. In determining cash flows, yes guys, what are the factors to be considered as far as determination of cash flows is concerned? For us to identify this, we'll have to take into consideration a few factors. The most important or the easiest one that we can take into consideration to estimate the future cash flows, because what will be the cash flows that will be estimated from continuing use of the asset? What could be the easiest identification? The easiest identification is, in determining the cash flows, an enterprise can use the budgets and forecasts prepared by the management. Budgets and forecasts which are prepared by the management. This will be the prima facie evidence for identifying your cash flows. But now I'm going to give you a very, very interesting thing for estimation of your cash flows. what we can say is such budgets or forecasts you can take, but the period not exceeding 5 years. I can take budgets and forecasts, but to ensure that my period of cash flow should not exceed a period of 5 years. Now, what if the useful life was more than 5 years? Now, this is a very interesting question which will come up. If the useful life exceeds 5 years, then the future cash flows beyond 5 years should be estimated by extrapolation. What is extrapolation? Extrapolation is basically means I am estimating the future cash flows based on a steady growth rate or a declining growth rate. I can use either a steady growth rate or I can use a declining growth rate. I'm talking about steady or declining growth rate. What is a steady growth rate or declining growth rate which I am talking about? When I use the word steady or declining growth rate, you need to understand that my growth rate, that is G, represented by G, can be 0 or negative. I don't mind being this. I don't mind this. Because I can have a declining growth rate as well. But remember, your factor G cannot be incremental growth rate. In estimating future cash flows, you can never have an incremental growth rate factor in estimating the future cash flows. Got it? So this is something that you have to really understand critically in this case, because what you will observe from this is the estimation of cash flows should be predominantly based on budgets and forecasts. But once you take the budgets and forecasts, such budgets and forecasts are reliable only for 5 years. So if I'm at year zero, I can only take into consideration up to year five. Any budget or forecast prepared beyond 5 years period will not be considered as reliable information. Then that beyond 5 years period, how will I identify? If the useful life of the asset is 12 years, then only 5 years estimation is wrong. So I will have to take into consideration the growth rate. So I'll have to extrapolate and identify the cash flows beyond 5 years based on a particular growth rate, which should always be in a steady or declining manner. You cannot take an incremental growth rate here. This is what we are trying to understand when we are talking about estimated cash flows. So that is the reason why I said use a steady or growth rate, but your growth rate can be negative or even a zero, but you cannot have an incremental growth rate. Growth rate cannot be considered as 6%, 8%, 10%, 12%. No. 6%, 6%, 6%, 6%, 6%. Or 6%, 5%, 4%, 3%, 2%, 1%. Steady growth rate or declining growth rate is fine. But only thing is, incremental growth rate cannot be considered. This is how I will estimate the cash flows. Once I've estimated the cash flows and applied a discount rate, I will try to identify what is the amount of value in use. You're talking about inclusions of cash flows. You're talking about estimation of cash flows. Then there are certain cash flows which should be excluded in computation of value in use. Number one. Then what are those cash flows which we have to exclude at the time of determining value in use? In simple sense, we said value in use is present value of all future cash flows. So all sum of all present value of future cash flows should be considered as the value in use. So this is some concept regarding identification of cash flows and determination of value in use. Certain cash flows should be excluded in determining value in use that we're going to look at. So yes, guys. So let's understand the exclusions from cash flows in identifying your values in use. We have seen our inclusions. Now let's identify our exclusions. Exclusions from cash flows in estimating value in use. When we're trying to estimate value in use, what are the exclusions that we have to count upon? Let's see in this. Now, my exclusions from cash flows can be broadly classified as 5 parts. Now, these exclusions are nothing but the first one, liabilities already recognized. Now you have a particular expense which is already recognized as a liability. Now that cash flow cannot, that a particular liability cannot be called as a cash outflow any further. Number two, future reconstruction expense which is not committed for. You haven't taken up any commitment for a future expense, but you have an intention. I have an intention to build on the additional capacity in future. Now, the additional capacity that you will build in future, I did not give a commitment to someone. I did not say you take up this activity of increasing the capacity of the asset. But I have an intention to do that. I will not be considering it in estimation of cash flows because you are trying to estimate the cash flow at that particular point of time on balance sheet date based on the facility of the asset on that particular date of measurement. We are not supposed to consider all our future events. Now, going forward, when I cannot take the expense, I cannot take the benefit. Benefits which are arising from future reconstruction expense. If I undertake that particular activity of future reconstruction, then I will get an additional benefit of 30%. Because I am not even considering the future commitment, if I haven't given the commitment, why will I even consider the benefit which will be arising out of that? Now, along with that, financing cash flows. That means your interest cannot be considered as a cash flow. Similarly, even your taxes. This exclusion here regarding taxes have something to do with even your discount factors. I'll tell you what that is. Since I've excluded taxes from the cash flows, remember that the discount rate applicable should also be a pre-tax rate. I forgot to mention that when we were discussing about discount factors. But remember that the discount rate is always a pre-tax rate. Why is it pre-tax? Because my cash flows are excluding taxes. So when my cash flows are excluding the taxes by tax value, the cash flows are pre-tax. Discount rate is also appropriately pre-tax in that. Got it? So these are certain exclusions which I will have to consider when I'm talking about estimation of value in use or estimation of cash flows for identifying value in use. Now, this is all good. What if an asset generates cash flows in foreign currency? I have an asset which is generating cash flows but such cash flows are being generated not in your home currency, but in a foreign currency that is other than your functional currency. Now, what happens when you have that situation? I have cash flows, but I have estimated the cash flows as dollar, 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 dollar. So I have year 1 to 7 cash flows which are estimated, and all cash flows which are estimated here are absolutely in dollars. Terminal cash flow at the end of 7th year also I have, which is also in dollars. Now, if I try to apply a discount rate here, then this discount rate which will be applicable will indicate the time value of foreign currency. Here I am talking about that is in dollars. Whenever I have an asset generating cash flow in foreign currency, don't try to convert the currency. Always make sure that you are taking the cash flows in foreign currency, but take the even the appropriate discount rate also in the same foreign currency. Now, when I apply this, I'm gonna get the present value of cash flows, which is also in dollars. I will multiply this dollar with the spot rate. In general sense, if I'm talking about a rupee value, rupee per dollar spot rate, and then I will get the value in use in rupee. So what am I doing? I am not converting the cash flow into rupee. I am taking the cash flow in foreign currency, discounting it with the time value of money in foreign currency. Applying the discount factors and cash flows, I will get present value of cash flow that is also in foreign currency. Now, this foreign currency which I got, I am discounting it using a spot rate that is today's date. Why did I take today's date? Because it is present value of cash flows. Present value means identified on today's date. Today's date of value in use, I'll multiply it with today's spot rate, and that is how I will get the value in use in your functional currency. Got it? This is how we are gonna make an estimate of future cash flows whenever I have an asset which is generating cash flows in foreign currency. Now, this will end our concept of identifying your value in use. Now, value in use, determination based on cash flows and discount rate, inclusions, exclusions, and estimation of cash flows is what we have understood. And also cash flows, if they are generated in foreign currency by a particular asset. Now, this will end as value in use. Now, we will start looking at the entire concept put together. What was your concept? Carrying value of asset reduced by the amount of recoverable amount will give me what is impairment loss. Now, we have identified that recoverable amount is higher of value in use or net selling price. I have determined net selling price. I have also identified value in use now. Now, I have also got what is impairment loss. Remember, I will recognize an impairment loss only when the recoverable amount is less than carrying value. I will recognize impairment only if the recoverable amount is less than the carrying value of asset. Remember, guys, if your recoverable amount is greater than the carrying value, then there is no impairment loss on that particular asset. Then how do I recognize the impairment loss? What is the method of recognition has to be understood. But remember, what we have done so far is only the measurement of recoverable amount. We haven't seen the recognition of impairment loss yet. We will have to see two concepts: recognition of impairment loss and reversal of such impairment losses. Yes, guys. So we were talking about impairment. Let's go further into recognition of impairment losses. Recognition of impairment. We have till now discussed about measurement of impairment. We haven't seen what is your recognition of impairment losses, whether I have to identify with the value of the asset or to the P&L or any other place. Now, whenever we are looking at recognition of impairment losses, we need to understand the first and the major concept that if the recoverable amount exceeds the carrying value, then in such cases, no impairment at all. But if in case it is the other way around, that is my recoverable amount falls short or is less than the carrying value, then we have to recognize impairment. Now, this is what we have to understand with respect to recognition of impairment losses. Now, first of all, let's see, when we are talking about recognition of impairment in this case, how do we recognize the impairment loss? Recognition of impairment losses means the loss has to be recognized always into the P&L. Impairment should be recognized in P&L. So understand, what is the accounting entry that we pass? Remember, the first thing, like I told you, we are reducing the value of an asset because it is a loss in the value of an asset. So loss in the value of an asset means I have to reduce the asset. I'll write it as 2 asset, and the debit has to go into the P&L account. I'll record the entry like this. But if in case the asset was earlier revalued upwards, if the asset was revalued upwards earlier, previously, then what happens? There is a revaluation reserve which is existing. So all the entire amount of impairment loss to the extent of revaluation reserve being available has to be recognized in revaluation reserve itself. So I'll pass the entry as revaluation reserve account debit. To asset. This entry would be passed if the asset was revalued upwards earlier. This is the concept of what we understand under recognition of impairment loss. Guys, understand, here when we're looking at recognition of impairment losses, we are only concentrating on reducing the value of an asset, which is common. The only thing which I have done different is only with regard to either the P&L or revaluation reserve. Now, whenever we are looking at recognition of impairment loss, we'll also have to look at another very typical concept called reversal of impairment losses. Why does this reversal actually happen? A reversal of impairment loss generally happens when the recoverable amount suddenly increases. We are not calling it as your impairment gain, but instead we are calling it reversal of losses, because a reversal means an asset which was earlier impaired should only check for the reversal of impairment loss. Yes, guys. So like I told you, we'll have to talk about something called as reversal of impairment loss. Understand the concept or the nomenclature being used there. When I use the word, I said it is reversal of impairment loss.
Reversal of impairment loss means it will be only identified on such assets which were earlier impaired. If the asset was never impaired earlier, then you don't have to check for reversal of impairment loss at all. Check only if the asset was impaired earlier.
Now, when we are looking at this concept of reversal of impairment loss, we will have to understand when does this even happen. This happens only when in a situation where the recoverable amount exceeds the amount of carrying value. So I'm saying that this will happen only when the recoverable amount exceeds the carrying value of asset. Now, whenever this situation appears and the asset was earlier impaired, we'll have to check for reversal of impairment loss. How do we reverse the impairment loss on a particular asset? Remember, guys, when you're looking at reversal, you have to be very interesting concept comes up. Reversal can be to the extent of lower of number one, recoverable amount minus carrying value. This is a normal formula because you are comparing the carrying value and the recoverable amount. Or the second situation that's going to appear here is that the carrying value of the asset if such impairment was not recognized earlier, minus the carrying value of asset. Observe what I've written. I've written two things out here. I said the recoverable amount, the carrying value should be lower of the amount of reversal should be lower of recoverable amount minus carrying amount, or the carrying value if such impairment loss was not recognized earlier. What are these two concepts which are coming up now? Let us say, for example, I have a situation like this which has arisen. For example, I'm talking about, let's say in the year one, I have an asset like this, carrying value was about 100, had a useful life of 5 years, assume that the residual value was zero, then the depreciation which would be charged per annum would have been 20. This was the case. For example, I'm talking about, let's say if it was impaired by 20 rupees, then what happened? The revised carrying value would be 80. Take the same 5 years period, depreciation which have been charged per annum would have been 16. Now, considering both the situations, let's see what we do. This impairment was recognized in year one. Let's say, for example, year three, I'm assessing the situation. In year three, when I'm assessing the situation, the carrying value of asset is equal to
80 after impairment minus 16 is the amount of depreciation for 2 years, 32, I'll be left out with 48 being the revised carrying value. For example, let's say I've understood that reversal of impairment loss that is recoverable amount minus the carrying value has come up to 20 again. If this is the situation which I am right now dealing with, then understand. I am saying I cannot recognize the entire 20 rupees of reversal. I am saying that this 20 rupees cannot be considered as reversal. Why? Even though it is same as the amount of impairment loss which was charged earlier, understand, I should only make sure that I am taking the lower of these two. So I'll say, or the carrying value of the asset if the impairment was not charged earlier. Carrying value if impairment not charged earlier. If it was not charged earlier, then my value would have been 100 minus 2 years, I would have charged 20 rupees depreciation, I would have got 60. What is the carrying amount after impairment? Carrying value after impairment is equal to 48. A difference between 48 and 60 is 12. So my reversal can happen only to the extent of lower of these two. So if I apply the same thing here, this is coming down to 20 while this is coming down to 12. So the reversal should only be the lower of these two. So I'll only recognize 12 as reversal. Understand, if I reverse it by 12, what happens to the asset now? The carrying value today is 48. I'm reversing it by 12. So the revised carrying value will become 60. What is 60? 60 is the carrying value of an asset if such impairment loss was not charged early. Understand, in this scenario, what are we trying to say? We are trying to prove that do whatever, I will not let you revalue the asset. See, what we are saying, what we are doing here by reversing the 12 rupees is not revaluation. It is again coming back to the value of the asset if such impairment loss was not charged earlier. That's why I said the word reversal of impairment loss. The reason why I use the terminology like this is specifically because we are only reversing it to the extent if such impairment loss was not charged earlier, what would be the carrying value of the asset? I am restoring the asset back to that value, but I am not increasing the value of an asset beyond this 60. This 60 is the maximum I can do the reversal for. Got it? So this is the concept which is behind the reversal of impairment loss. Very interesting and very identical concept, guys. It is very logical for us to understand why we have done so. Clear? After this elaborate discussion, most of us might be of an opinion that we are already done with the concept of impairment. But unfortunately, this is the beginning point. I'll tell you why I would say that this is a beginning, because this is a simple understanding of the standard so far. Now let's try to complicate it, because we are not really comfortable taking a very simple concept as far as our IND-AS is concerned. We like complicating the entire concept as a whole, because when I put some practicality into the situation, the entire logics will go for a toss. I'll tell you why. I'll take a simple example, okay? For example, let's say I had a production process like this that is an input. I had one production plant, that is plant A, which was again providing some intermediary good which is going into plant B. From plant B, I was getting some
output or the finished good. This is my production process. Now let me try to understand here. I am trying to say that, let's say I've inserted paper. Then let's say this was a wax coating machine and it gave me an intermediate product, that is wax paper. This wax paper, I can call it as intermediary. Let's say B was cutting and packing in the required sizes and I got an output. This was basically my output as of desired size. Now this is what I have. Let's say I'm looking at a production process like this. Normally we use this wax paper in multiple situations. For a biscuit, normally the biscuits are packed or wrapped in a particular wax paper which comes underlying the cover. So such wax paper, or you normally use it even for the blade, right? So whenever you have a normal blades, those blades are normally covered with a thin type of wax kind of paper so that the blade does not cut the edges out. So this is a simple production process. I'm not complicating the production process. I took the most easiest production process that you can have. And I'm saying that a combination of this is what we are trying to identify. Now when I have a situation like this, the problem comes up to me because here, if you want to talk about each one is a particular asset. This is asset number one, while this is asset number two. Now I try to identify the recoverable amount. How do you identify recoverable amount? To identify recoverable amount, I need to take higher of either the net selling price or the value in use. Now when we try to identify the value in use out here, this place, when I wanted to identify the value in use, I came across a very genuine problem. The genuine problem that appears to me here is that I am not able to identify cash flows. Cash flows cannot be identified for asset 1 and 2, that is A and B, individually. That means they are generating cash flows on combined basis. When you're generating cash flows but they are not generating cash flows on individual asset basis, this situation crops up. Whenever this situation crops up, this is where I will say you cannot identify impairment loss for individual assets. I am trying to say that in this situation, the recognition of impairment loss on individual assets is not possible when they generate cash flows on combined basis. Combined processes. Whenever there's a combined process and it is not possible for you to identify the amount of impairment loss, this is where we are stuck. I wanted to apply the standard that I've learned so far. I came across this situation. I said, sir, I have to apply it to asset A and asset B. I'll have to check whether my recoverable amount is higher than the carrying value. If no, then I will start recognizing the impairment loss. But when I tried to identify the cash flows were not possible because both assets on a combined basis were generating output and this output is being sold. So it is not possible for me to identify what is the impairment loss for each individual asset. That is a situation where in such cases, identify impairment for combination of assets. Impairment for group of assets. Such group of assets is normally termed as CGU. It is called as CGU. What does CGU stand for? CGU means a cash generating unit. This is what a CGU stands for. Now, when do I say that there is a combination which is required, or can I identify on individual basis? This logic becomes very simple. For us to explain this concept, I will take into consideration the intermediary good. Whenever I look at this intermediary good, I will try to say that intermediary goods can be classified. How do you want to classify them? I'll classify them into two types. Where active market exists where there is no active market. Whenever active market exists, then identify impairment for individual assets. But whenever we are looking at no active market exists, in such situation, identify impairment for a cash generating unit that's a combination of assets. This is what we are looking at when we talk about impairment loss. When there is a group of assets, they are generating cash flows on a combination basis or on a combined process in such a way that it is not, we are not able to differentiate them. So how do I define a CGU? CGU is a smallest identifiable group of assets. Smallest identifiable group of assets generating cash flows which are largely independent of other assets or group of assets. Look at the situation here. We are trying to define a CGU and we are saying that a CGU is the smallest identifiable group of assets. Why did I use the word smallest identifiable group? CGU is smallest identifiable group of assets. Why did I use this terminology here? Reason is, if I wouldn't have said smallest identifiable group, and if I simply continued the definition as CGU is a group of assets or identifiable group of assets, then we will start considering it to make ourselves easy or to make the interpretation of the standard easy. We would say the entire assets in the organization together are generating one single cash flow, so they can be called as one single CGU. Now, to avoid that, he has written smallest identifiable. That means you have to break it down into small parts. Which one is the smallest group you identify, and such group of assets, if they generate cash flows largely independent of other assets or group of assets, you can call them as one CG. Guys, understand, if there is a dependence between different assets for generating cash flows, then in such situation, you will have to group all those assets into one single CGU. Now, the question arises, how do I group them? The grouping of assets within the CGU, and can I regroup the assets which are already included in the CGU in the previous financial years? That will be a very interesting question to answer. A typical concept that we were looking at is CGU.
And what did we say regarding a CGU? CGU was a cash generating unit. And we said it is the smallest identifiable group of assets which generate cash flows largely independent of other group of assets or individual assets.
Now, when we are looking at CGU, understand, an asset should always be allocated on a reasonable and consistent basis to a CGU.
Assets should be allocated on a reasonable and consistent basis to a CGU.
Now, understand, along with that, what we have to see here is assets being allocated on a reasonable and consistent basis to CGU. We'll also have to observe that is there anything that we can reclassify the asset for reasonable and consistent basis. That means once an asset is allocable to a particular CGU, you need to continue to allocate the asset to the same CGU every financial year whenever you test for impairment. However, an asset can be reclassified to another cash generating unit if it is justified. So it is not a very strict rule that you have to apply that it should be done on a reasonable and consistent basis. There is a relaxation which is provided saying that yes, you can reclassify, you can make sure that it is allocated to another set of CGU, but provided it should be justified. When I say the word justified here, justified indicates change in utilization of asset. What is a change in utilization of asset? Let's understand with an example. When I say utilization of asset change, understand, can happen like this. Let's say an asset was initially used for server room. A server compulsory requires an AC because the server normally has a problems regarding heating. So I have been allocating the AC to the CGU of the server. But subsequently, the effectiveness of the AC was gradually reducing. So I replaced the AC and I made sure that the old AC was fitted to my staff, because it was good enough for the staff, not good enough for the server room. So what is happening here? The asset which was earlier classified to the CGU of the server has now to be reclassified under the staff, Now this is a justifiable reason because you have changed the utilization of the particular asset. This is what we have to understand with classification of an asset to a CGU, which should be done on a reasonable and consistent basis. Now, whenever we identify the impairment loss to a CGU, understand impairment of CGU is equal to sum of all the carrying amounts of assets within the CGU reduced by less the recoverable amount of CGU. For us to identify this component out here, that is recoverable amount of CGU, we will have to identify both the components, that is the net selling price and the value in use of the CGU. This is higher of value in use of CGU or net selling price of CGU. Understand, let's say there was an impairment loss to the asset. How do I recognize the impairment loss? Impairment loss of CGU. What is this concept of impairment loss of CGU and why is it important for us to understand this? I'll tell you. Let's say the CGU included three assets, asset A, B and C. Now there is an impairment loss. Such impairment loss which you have identified for the CGU has to be allocated to each individual asset. Has to be identified or allocated to each individual asset of the CGU. So I'll have to ensure that I'm distributing the asset, the impairment loss to each asset within the CGU. On what basis should be distributed to each individual asset in the ratio of the carrying value of assets within the CGU. Carrying value of assets within the CGU. So that means in this case we are supposed to take the ratio as A is to B is to C and distribute the impairment loss on the CGU to each individual asset within the CGU. This in a sense is the concept of impairment loss on CGU. And remember guys, even your reversal will have to take the same effect. Whenever you are looking at reversal of impairment loss, to a CGU, even such reversal should be allocated to each asset in the ratio of their carrying values. So it has to be allocated in the basis of ratio of their carrying values. Guys, remember, guys, when we are doing this, you will have to always remember that the reversal is again subjected to a maximum of the carrying value of assets if such impairment loss was not recognized earlier. This situation has to always comply whenever we are seeing reversal of impairment loss. Whenever I come across the concept of reversal of impairment loss, this situation will always hold good. So what are we saying? The asset within a CGU should always be allocated to the same CGU on a reasonable and consistent basis every year. I am not supposed to reclassify the asset unless it is justified. What is justification means? When I use the utilization of the asset has completely changed, in such situation, I will change the classification of asset to a CGU. Number two, whenever we identify the impairment loss of a CGU, such impairment loss has to be distributed to each individual asset in the CGU. On what basis do I distribute? In the basis of the ratio of their carrying values, that is A's to B's to C, such ratio has to be considered for distributing the impairment loss to each individual asset within the CGU. Now, next we are talking about reversal of impairment loss, and I said whenever there's a reversal, such reversal should also be in the same ratio of the carrying value of each individual asset within the CGU. However, it has to be subjected to a maximum of the amount of the carrying value of asset. If such impairment loss was never charged earlier, then what would have been the carrying value? That should be the maximum value to which I can reverse the amount of impairment loss. Yes, guys. So one very typical asset that we have to discuss about is goodwill. Because testing for impairment loss in goodwill becomes really difficult. I'll tell you why. Now, what was the impairment formula that we have seen? We have understood the impairment as the difference between, if I want to identify impairment, I would say impairment is equal to carrying value of asset, this I can identify, no problem, minus recoverable amount. What is recoverable amount? For our purpose of identifying your impairment loss, my recoverable amount can be understood as higher of value in use or net selling price. Correct? This is what we have understood so far as far as impairment is concerned. Now comes the question. I want to identify impairment for goodwill. When I want to identify impairment of goodwill, one thing which I can understand very clearly is that in impairment of goodwill, the value in use is very difficult to establish, with a reason that you do not recognize any value or you do not quantify any value in terms of cash flows for goodwill. Because what is goodwill? Goodwill in practical sense means future excess earning capacity. How do you assess goodwill? Assessment of goodwill should go as per Ind AS 103. How do you assess goodwill? Identify the difference between the consideration which is paid to acquire the control of the assets minus the net assets of the company. So when you identify the difference between these two, you are saying that the assets and liabilities, the net assets on a combination, are going to give me some future extra economic benefit over and above their carrying value. Such extra amount which you are paying over and above the carrying value of the assets and liabilities, we have quantified it as goodwill. Now in this case, value in use cannot be established because value in use is present value of future cash flows.
Now, present value of future cash flows cannot be established.
Net selling price, estimated fair value on disposal.
What is the estimated fair value and disposal of a goodwill cannot be identified.
So I cannot identify either the value in use, neither I can identify the amount of net selling price. When I can't identify these two, then how do I even identify the impairment on goodwill? So to identify and recognize impairment loss on goodwill, we have to undergo a small procedure. What do we do? For recognizing impairment loss on goodwill, goodwill should be allocated on a reasonable and consistent basis to individual assets or group of assets. Such group of assets, in our terminology of Ind AS 36, we call them as CGU.
So we are here to identify that we'll have to reasonably allocate the amount of goodwill. What would be the reasonable allocation of goodwill? When we are looking at this word, reasonable and consistent allocation of goodwill, then we'll have to understand that this goodwill should be allocated on non-arbitrary basis. What is non-arbitrary basis means? Non-arbitrary basis means the management assessment should not be considered. Not at management discretion. You cannot rely on the discretion of the management to identify this value. And what basis? Now, to identify the allocation of goodwill, we need to adopt a very, very interesting technique for identification. This allocation of goodwill should happen in a very interesting model.
We use something called as bottom up approach. We are using something called as bottom up approach.
What is this bottom up approach?
Bottom up approach is basically saying that you have to first identify the value of goodwill with respect to individual asset. If you cannot allocate the goodwill to individual asset, then try to adopt it for group of assets. If you cannot allocate it to group of assets, then allocate it to CG. However, this bottom up approach was that which was given as per Ind AS 38, not useful in Ind AS 36. What is Ind AS 36 talking about? Something called as top-down approach. This is what is emphasized as far as Ind AS 36 is concerned. What is this model of top-down?
Top-down, for essence, in simple sense, means I have enterprise and such enterprise in its financial statements have recognized a goodwill. Okay?
Now we'll have to understand.
Let's say this enterprise is basically engaged in operation at three places. One in India, one let's say in US, third one let's say in UK. In India, I have three particular places based on which I do my operations. One I said South, North and Central India.
again among South India, I started bifurcating. I said this goes to Tamil Nadu, put a certain amount in AP, a certain amount in Karnataka. Again in AP and Tamil Nadu, let's say I'm taking Tamil Nadu, again I'll have different places. Can go to Chennai or Coimbatore or Madurai, this way. And at each location I have multiple assets. Let's say in Chennai I have 3 assets, A1, A2, A3. Top down approach indicates this way. What are we trying to do now? We are trying to say that in a top down approach, the enterprise level goodwill will be trying to allocate it based on different locations. This is called as organization hierarchy. This is called as organization hierarchy. Based on the organization hierarchical chart, we will have to distribute goodwill to either the Indian location or the US location or the UK location. Now, after this allocation is done, then we will have to see if I have a goodwill here. While there is no goodwill here in US and UK, I have not been making sufficient profits to recognize a goodwill in these two locations. Then I'll have to allocate the goodwill among these three divisions. Let's say I identified that there's a goodwill in South zone. I do not have any goodwill in each North and Central division. Then I'll have to allocate goodwill again here. I have a portion of goodwill to be allocated here, portion of goodwill to be allocated here, and a portion of goodwill to be allocated here. This way, I have to adopt a top-down approach in allocating goodwill. Sometimes, beyond a particular point, you cannot allocate goodwill. Let's say Tamil Nadu has a portion of goodwill which I allocated, but I cannot identify which particular place in Tamil Nadu is actually getting that amount of goodwill. Which operation? Is it my Chennai operation which is deriving me extra benefit, or my Coimbatore operation is generating extra benefit, or my Madurai operation is creating extra benefit? This I don't know. I only could allocate it till here. Then no problem. Stop it till there. Then you recognize goodwill, the impairment of goodwill, based on all the assets which belong to that particular. For example, you don't want to do all this. What do? In a top-down approach, at least the enterprise level goodwill can be identified. So stop there. You don't have to allocate any further. You only identify the goodwill based on enterprise level itself. So this way, I can identify impairment of goodwill when it is allocated to assets or group of assets on a reasonable and consistent basis, which should be non-arbitrary. It should not be at the discretion of the management. It should be based on the facts and circumstances of each case, and it should follow a top-down approach based on organization hierarchy. This is the concept of allocation of goodwill. Then we'll have to look at how do I recognize the impairment loss in goodwill? What about the reversal of impairment loss on such particular asset of goodwill? So what we have understood till now is that we are not going to check for impairment loss of goodwill as a loan asset. We'll have to check in combination with other assets. So when we are looking for impairment of goodwill, one thing which we have to be very clear about is that goodwill individually is not checked for impairment. Goodwill is not checked for impairment individually but along with other assets or group of assets. Now, when we are looking at this situation, what we are trying to talk about is how to check for, how to recognize the impairment loss on goodwill. Remember one single thing which I'm going to tell you now, that impairment loss should be first provided to goodwill allocated and then the balance to the asset or group of assets. Group of assets. Understand what we are saying here. We are saying that the impairment should be first provided on goodwill. That means first provided. That means goodwill should be first being impaired. Whenever I say a portion of goodwill is allocated to a particular asset, always remember that that particular value of goodwill allocated should be the first one which will be impaired. The balance, if any, should be allocated to individual assets or group of assets. So the first asset to be impaired will be goodwill. Then reversal of impairment on goodwill, when we look at reversal of impairment on goodwill, like we have seen reversal of impairment against different assets, should I reverse even the impairment loss on goodwill when it was already impaired earlier? This is not allowed as per Ind AS 36. No reversal of impairment loss under goodwill. This is what we can understand regarding impairment loss on goodwill and their reversal of impairment loss. So what are we trying to say? First to be impaired will be the goodwill allocated to the asset or group of assets. And reversal of an impairment loss on goodwill which was earlier recognized can never happen. You will have to make sure that you are never recognizing a reversal on impairment loss of goodwill. Got it? Now, whenever we are talking impairment, remember, always check for impairment only if indicator of impairment exists. Only when there is an indicator of impairment, we'll have to check for impairment loss. What is this indicator of impairment? That means I am not supposed to check for impairment loss for each individual asset on each balance sheet date. No, I will check for impairment loss only if I find an indicator of impairment. These indicators of impairment can be identified as two ways. One is called as external sources of information. And the other one is internal source of information. Understand, guys, whenever we are looking at internal and external sources of information, we'll have to be specific on what are these indicators of impairment. But understand, whatever I give as a list out here, they are only an inclusive list. It is not an exhaustive list. So a few to name which I'm talking about here is increase in discount rate. If your discount rate increases, what happens? What is discount rate? It is your market assessment of time value of money. Market assessment, not your individual assessment. So if the individual market assessment of time value of money increases, then the value in use will fall. Because the same cash flows, when discounted at a higher rate of discount rate, then will always result in a lower figure of value in use. So this is one reason of external factor. Second reason which I wanted to give was probably regarding
adverse effects on market or technology or legal environment that means let's say
a particular market is completely down, software segment is down because majorityly software depends on export. Let's say there was a restriction which Trump has imposed on any import of items which are relating to services, then what will happen? Automatically the segment drops. That is a market impact. Technology impact, I did not do anything, but market technology has significantly changed. My technology which I am adopting right now has become outdated because of that. One reason. Legal environment, a particular product which I am manufacturing under the process has been termed as illegal. You're not supposed to do that, has been prohibited under the law. So all such things will be indicators of impairment loss. Or number three, we can also look at a situation where
decrease in utility of asset beyond normal decline. Normally, I know it will decline, but here it is declining much more than what it is expected due to some external factor. That could be one reason where there could be a significant change, significant fall in the value of asset. Now, when I'm looking at internal source of information, you can say my change in facilities of manufacture, visible decline in productivity, adverse change in use of asset. It was earlier used for a particular purpose, now it has been changed.
So this way we can say that these are certain changes, there are certain things which we can attribute it to internal sources of information. Remember, this is not exhaustive but an inclusive list. That means I can have a lot more items which can be included under this list. You cannot say that these are the only factors, but all I am trying to say that there are certain factors which will tell you that there might be an impairment. Once you see that there might be an impairment, then only we will check for impairment. After you check for impairment, then I will derive whether there is an impairment loss or not. Even though there is an indicator, there could be a situation where the impairment might not be charged. Why? Because the recoverable amount is greater than the carrying value. Then in such cases, even though the indicator exists, the asset is not impaired. This way, we have to understand that there are few situations where we observe that the impairment need not be charged on certain assets. Now guys, that means you are saying an asset will be checked for impairment only if you find some internal or external source of information that there could be a decline in the value of an asset. Correct? Absolutely no. There is always an exceptional rule, and they'll say that there is certain exception which will make sure that there are certain assets which will have to be checked for impairment on each balance sheet date. I'll have to check for impairment on each balance sheet date. So I will have to make sure that I'll have to not look at the indicators, but every year at least once I'll have to check for impairment on those assets. What assets are these and how do we even test for them? We'll have to look at that. Yes guys, so like I told you, there are certain exceptions. Exceptions to indicators of impairment.
That means even though I don't find any indicator, I'll have to compulsory test for impairment here.
What are these exceptions and why do we have to actually impair these assets?
There are only three exceptions which will apply. Number one, intangible asset with indefinite life.
This we will understand when we look at IND AS 38, intangible asset. There we say that there could always be an intangible asset which does not have a finite life. I cannot tell you that this asset will have a useful life of 5 years, this asset will have a useful life of 10 years. Such kind of items. Number two, intangible assets not put to use. I have an intangible asset, but I have not yet put to use. I haven't used it. I still have the asset with me. Guys, the first one, indefinite life, understand what are those assets which will be covered under this. But ultimately, I can tell you that both are covered as far as IND AS 36 is concerned. I'm just giving you a further explanation to that. Indefinite life. Now, let's say a music composer has come up with some classics of Kishore Kumar or Mohammed Rafi, and he has a patent over the property of those songs. Even today those songs are being sold. Even today we have people who have an ear for those songs. Now at that point of time, which is almost 20 or 30 years or couple of decades back, such songs being recorded which even today have some useful life. So what are we saying? Such assets, we cannot define saying that this is the useful life or this is the useful life. Look at a movie like Sholay, man. It's a motion picture. It is a patent. It is a copyright that they have. It is an intangible asset. What is the useful life of that particular asset? It is even generating the revenue today also. Now that is what we are talking about. Indefinite life. You cannot define a particular life for that. Intangible asset not yet put to use. I have taken it, but I haven't used it. Guys, unless and until the intangible asset is being used, I can't charge any amortization on that. Since I can't charge amortization, I'm testing for impairment. So whatever it is, whether impairment or amortization, ultimately I'm trying to reduce the value. So I'm reducing the value here. Now this is predominantly a factor of research and development expenditure. This can be understood under research and development. Will be explained under IND AS 36 itself. So when we are looking at these two assets, we are also having three assets. I told you the third asset, which I have to compulsory test for impairment. There is no exception rule here. This is goodwill on business combinations. Goodwill arising on business combinations, arising as per IND AS 103. Compulsory, we have to test for impairment on each financial year, at least each financial year. So I will tell you what we are supposed to do here. Here what we are supposed to do is these assets should be tested for impairment at least once in each financial year. And when I say at least once, some of them might think that always compulsory on balance sheet date. I'll add that also. Need not be done on balance sheet date. You don't have to do it on each balance sheet date, but ensure that you are doing it at least once each year. Enough. And I want to add one more thing here, is sometimes we might have a situation which can come up where we are talking about acquisition. Test for impairment in the financial year of acquisition, compulsory I have to test for impairment in the year in which I have acquired any of these three assets. Either it could be intangible assets or it could be the goodwill arising on business combination. These have to be tested at least once at the time of financial year, at least in the year of, once during the year of acquisition. Now these are exceptions. We'll talk about a very, very, very interesting concept I'm talking here is, can I have this way that the impairment exceeds the carrying value of asset? Interesting, right? Observe what I wrote. Impairment exceeds the carrying value of asset. What concept am I actually bringing out here to be included under this? This is interesting. I'll tell you why it becomes interesting, because when I want to check for impairment, what is the value? Impairment is equal to carrying value minus recoverable amount. But I am saying that there could be this situation appear. How can that be possible? See, even if the recoverable amount is zero, I should find carrying impairment is equal to carrying value. But I am saying not necessary. I can have a situation where it exceeds the amount of carrying value. Why does this even happen? This will happen in mathematical sense if my recoverable amount is zero. If my recoverable amount is negative, if negative, then you can say that this is true. Why would your recoverable amount is be negative, man? What is your recoverable amount? Higher of value in use or net selling price? Then higher of those two, at least one should be zero, no? Take one as zero. Zero is definitely higher than negative figure. Why should my recoverable amount be negative? Yes. I'll tell you. If an asset cannot be used but should be disposed under an obligation. Now, such obligation can be legal obligation or a contractual obligation that you have agreed to dispose the asset. In such case, VIU should not be considered. And your net selling price, if fair value on disposal is zero, then in such case, NSP is equal to minus cost of disposal. Your net selling price is equal to minus cost of disposal. What am I saying? This is a typical situation which I am talking about. I am talking about a situation where the asset cannot be used. If it cannot be used, then value in use should not be considered at all. In such case, NSP should be considered. But even in the NSP, the fair value is considered to be zero. Then what do you do? NSP is equal to fair value on disposal minus cost of disposal. Fair value on disposal is zero, so NSP becomes negative cost of disposal. When it is negative cost of disposal, apply it here. Minus of minus cost of disposal, then impairment will exceed the carrying value. In such case, how do I recognize? In such situations, create a provision for estimated cost of disposal. I'll create a provision for estimated cost of disposal. I'll tell you why I've done this, because when I write an accounting entry, I have a problem. I'll write impairment account debit because it's an expense. I'll charge it off to P&L at a later point of time. So I'm just writing in brackets P&L as well. To asset, this is fine. But I cannot credit the entire thing to asset because the impairment exceeds the carrying value. To provision for cost of disposal. To provision for cost of disposal. That is the accounting treatment to be done. And why does this situation really arise? And I said the asset cannot be used, should be disposed under an obligation. What obligation am I talking about? I can have normally a legal obligation here. Let's say a rule has been passed under the law saying that this particular plant and machinery which I own is not eligible to be used. It is prohibited. Earlier, a few decades back, we had a situation similarly regarding two-stroke motorbikes. Very recently, we have come up with plastic. The non-recyclable plastic material cannot be used. Let's say I had a plant and machinery which was involved in manufacturing of such non-recyclable plastic. Then the government passed an order saying that this asset cannot be used. Value in use is zero. Okay, then let me find a buyer then. I went into the open market. I said, sir, my machinery, will you want to buy? That fellow said, even I have seen, man. Even I have got my government order in hand, which is clearly saying that that kind of assets are normally prohibited from use. So that means I can't use it. Even if I want to sell, the buyer is not ready to pay. So what else I have to do? I have to remove the asset and throw it somewhere. I have to dispose it. Such disposal is the cost which I will incur. Whenever such situation arises, then the impairment loss will exceed your carrying value of asset. In such case, the amount of cost of disposal should be created as a provision and the entire asset should be written off from books by recognizing an impairment loss. I'll recognize an impairment loss exceeding the carrying value. So I've written off the asset completely and the amount excess is a cost of disposal for which I created a provision. This in essence is the entire concept of IND AS 38 regarding impairment. Very peculiar concept, guys. This has to be considered as really important because this normally does not arise. The situation is a very peculiar situation which has arisen and has been tested a lot of times.